Our speaker today is Ron Jones. Ron is a longtime member of North Shore Unitarian. He is a globe-trotting traveler and accomplished hiker. Ron is also digitally literate. As you may have noticed, he has been controlling today's audio effects himself from his iPod. Today he will be speaking on travel as a path towards enlightenment, using illustrations from his Camino pilgrimages and travels. Ron will explain how these journeys have helped him to see beyond the box of our culture and gain a better understanding of our world. Ron, over to you. I'm going to go sit down there so I can see the picture too.
Picture will come a little later. There's a famous passage in Plato's Republic in which he invites us to imagine a cave in which prisoners are chained together in such a way that they can only look at the back wall of the cave. Behind the prisoners, there's a fire, and in front of the fire, there is a kind of puppeteer who holds up shapes so that the fire acts as a projector to cast flickering shadows onto the back wall of the cave. The prisoners have always been in the cave, and so their total experience of life is the cave and the flickering shadows cast up on the back wall. And so they believe that this is all there is to reality. It's all that they've ever experienced. Only if they could escape from their chains and make their way to the entrance of the cave would they realize that there is another world and another reality outside the cave. I sometimes think that we are all a little like those prisoners in the cave. We are all born into one moment of time, into one family, one place, one country, and usually one religion and one language. And while some of those things, such as language, can be important tools for expanding our knowledge and experience, many of those items act as borders and limit our awareness of reality. Travel helps us to transcend our ordinary, everyday life experiences. It can transport us to different languages, different landscapes, different cultures, different sensibilities, and a different sense of time. Here in Vancouver, the oldest buildings are little more than 100 years old, while in Europe, one encounters cathedrals that are over 1,000 years old, and Roman and Greek ruins that are more than 2,000 years old. And in Toulouse and Paris, there are bridges built in the 16th century, which people today still call the New Bridge. Visits to these places can give us a different sense of time. Today I want to tell you three stories from my travels about experiences that I believe have opened my eyes a little. The first story has to do with language. A few years ago, while I was studying Spanish in Guatemala, I was given an assignment to read a chapter in a Spanish textbook. The book pointed out that certain expressions to do with sex and relationships are quite different in Spanish compared to English. For example, if an old man is still interested in women and sex, he is sometimes called, in English, a dirty old man. But in Spanish, the corresponding expression is un viejo verde, a green old man, one in whom the juices are still flowing, like in a tree. And in English, if an unmarried couple are having an intimate short-term relationship, they are usually said to be having an affair. While in Spanish, the corresponding expression is una aventura, a an adventure. And if that couple weren't careful, they might have what we used to call in English a bastard or an illegitimate offspring. But what in Spanish would be called un bebé natural, a natural baby. I spoke recently to a linguistics professor about these differences, and she gave me some other examples. While in English we have many words for colors, in some languages there are only two words, light and dark. And in other languages use only one word for the colors that we call green and blue. There are also structural aspects of language that can create differences. As you know, many languages the words are either masculine or feminine. In some of these languages, the word for bridge is masculine, but in other languages, the word for bridge is feminine. And if you were to ask someone to explain about a bridge in a language where the word is masculine, they would tend to use powerful, strong, sturdy words for their concept of bridge. But if you were to ask a person who spoke a language where the word was feminine, they would tend to describe the bridge in more feminine terms. In this connection, the Argentinian author Jorge Luis Borges once remarked that different languages are not simply different collections of words. They are different ways of conceptualizing the universe. And so what I have learned from that Spanish exercise and Borges' observation is that when we use language to understand the world, the language we use is not neutral. Rather, it embodies the biases and the prejudices of the culture from which it has emerged. We may think that we are looking at the world as if through clear glass, but actually we are looking through lenses that have been finely ground by our particular culture. Now, let's see if we can get the machine. My second story is about what we might call a religious cult that is practiced in certain parts of Guatemala. Try to imagine that you have just entered a small house, and there in front of you is this figure with a carved wooden face. His name is Mashimon. His adherents believe that this figure is the physical representation of a supernatural deity. They believe that he can help them in their daily lives. I have seen men kneel before him and fervently pray to him. They bring him gifts of money and neckties that you can see in front of his chest. They put cigars and cigarettes in his mouth for him to smoke. And they tilt him back and pour liquor into his throat for him to drink. What may seem very strange to us is that at the side of the same room in which Maximoon resides, there are statues of Christian saints for whom people have also brought gifts of neckties, and even a glass casket with the figure of Jesus Christ inside. For centuries, the Catholic Church has been trying to stamp out the cult of Maximoon, but without success. When I first encountered Maximoon about 12 years ago, I tended to think of it as primitive, superstitious nonsense, as I think most Westerners would do. But recently, I've tried to be more objective and to look on it more kindly. I have tried to imagine what an anthropologist from another planet out in outer space, sent to observe religious practices here on Earth, what he would bring back as a report to his own planet after viewing different religious practices here on Earth. Wouldn't he find similarities between the cult of Maximoon and the Christian religion, especially as practiced in the Catholic Church? On my recent trip to Guatemala, I visited many Catholic churches, usually in a prominent position at the front of the church. There was a statue of the crucified Christ, a physical representation of a deity. And on many occasions, I wish I witnessed penitents fervently praying to this figure, sometimes crawling on their hands and knees, all the way to the front of the church and then back again. Now, my third story is about one of the things I believe I have learned from walking the Camino de Santiago. As you probably know, the Camino is a pilgrimage route found in France and Spain. There are actually many different routes, and what they all have in common is that they all lead to the city of Santiago de Compostela, a city in the northwest corner of Spain. I would like you to imagine that you are a pilgrim who has just arrived in Santiago at the end of your pilgrimage. Perhaps you've been walking every day for more than a month, for a distance of 800 kilometers, or perhaps for 2 months, for twice that distance. Like most pilgrims, on arrival, you would follow a well-established ritual. First, you would go to the cathedral to give thanks for your safe arrival. At the entrance to the cathedral, you would place your hand on a pillar that supports a statue of Santiago or St. James. Santiago is a Spanish expression for St. James. Over the centuries, so many pilgrims have placed their hands at the same place on the base of that pillar that an imprint of a human hand has been ground into the stone pillar. Then you would make your way to the front of the cathedral. You would mount some steps behind the altar and kiss the bejeweled cape of another statue of Santiago. Finally, you would descend into the crypt of the cathedral to see this finely engraved casket, which is believed to contain the remains of St. James. Now let us pause there for a moment and think about that idea. I believe it has been one of the most powerful ideas in human history, the idea that the remains of St. James are there in Santiago, now in that casket. But is it really true? St. James was the fourth apostle recruited by Jesus Christ. And there's a legend that after Christ's death, He went as a missionary to Galicia, the northwestern region of Spain. Around the year 800, when the word went out to the Christian world that his remains had been discovered in what is now Santiago, literally millions of pilgrims from all parts of Europe undertook the pilgrimage to Santiago. Some of the pilgrims brought rich gifts for the church, and as a result, first churches and then cathedrals were constructed all along the pilgrim routes. And to take care of sick pilgrims, the very first hospitals were built along the routes as well. Now, around this time, practically all of Spain was under the control of the Moors, or Moslems, who had come up into Spain from North Africa. Only a tiny kingdom in the north remained under a Christian king. But from here, a counter-assault was started, with the final result that the Moors were driven out and all of Spain became a Christian country. Santiago, or St. James, played a pivotal role in this reconquest. He was transformed from being a missionary into a knight in shining armor. Mounted on a white steed, he is said to have descended from the clouds and to have slain thousands of Moors in battle. He became a symbolic superhero and played a role in Spain similar to that of Joan of Arc in France. And he became the patron saint of all Spain. In the years that followed, Spain became united and became one of the most powerful nations in Europe. Explorers were sent out to all parts of the world, and Spain built up one of the greatest empires the world has ever witnessed. And so today, Spanish is still one of the world's main languages, and Spain is a part of Christian Europe. Whereas had it not been for the legend of St. James and his remains in that silver casket, Spain might still be a part of the Muslim world. But are his remains really in that silver casket? According to historical accounts, Santiago returned to Jerusalem after his missionary work in Spain. And at that time, Jerusalem was ruled by King Herod. King Herod didn't like Christians very much, and so he had Santiago's head chopped off. Because of his missionary work, St. James's friends thought that it might be appropriate for his body to be buried back in Galicia. And now the story becomes quite fantastic. Miraculously, a stone boat appeared without a crew and without a rudder, and transported Santiago's body all the way through the Mediterranean Sea, through the Straits of Gibraltar, and up the coast of Portugal to Spain, to Galicia, where the body was transported inland and buried. Over the next several centuries, the exact site of the burial place was forgotten until it was rediscovered around the year 800, and then the pilgrimage started from that point. Obviously, the story is hardly credible to a rational mind. It is even doubtful that Santiago ever set foot in Spain, since the first written mention of his having been there occurs only in the 6th century. I have walked many, many kilometers over the pilgrimage routes that lead to Santiago, and as I walked, I've often thought about that story. What I've learned from that travel experience is how powerful an idea can be. Powerful enough to be believed by millions of people, powerful enough to change the world, even though the idea isn't true. And that makes me wonder what ideas we may be accepting today in our culture that may be open to question. that may turn, ideas that may turn out in the end to be invalid. We need always to be mindful.